Okay, well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 15th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022, as we resume again in public session. Agenda item three on the committee's agenda this morning is a look at major capital projects. We get regular reports on the performance of major capital projects. What we were keen to do this morning was to examine the governance and accountability arrangements. So I'm very pleased that we've been joined by a panel of five to help us understand how those governance and accountability issues work. Can I welcome this morning Helen Carter, who's the Deputy Director, Infrastructure and Investment, Nick Ford, who's the Director of Scottish Procurement and Property, Alan Morrison, who's the Deputy Director, Health Infrastructure, Investment and PPE, yes, I thought there's a letter missing there. Andrew Watson, who's the Director for Budget and Public Spending in the Scottish Government. Last but not least, Lauren Shackman, who's the Director of Major Projects at Transport Scotland. We've not asked you to make an opening statement. Andrew, I think if it's okay, we'll use you as the conduit, but obviously there will be questions that relate to particular areas of work, and feel free to direct. And if other members of the panel want to come in at particular points, if you just indicate to me or to the clerks, and we'll do our best to bring you in. But I want to begin by asking the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, to open up with a question. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Can I start by asking more about the governance and management structures for overseeing the IIP, including how the IIB carries out its role and interacts with other boards and groups?
I'll maybe start on that question and then bring in a couple of colleagues if need be. So, as we set out in our paper, which I hope was a helpful kind of scene setter for this, the IIB is a place where we can draw strategic advice from across government, really, to inform the development of products like the Infrastructure Investment Plan, the IIP. We produce an IIP roughly every 5 years, and the intention behind the plan is to set out a medium-term vision in terms of the infrastructure projects and programmes that the government wants to take forward with delivery partners. In the case of the most recent IIP, that was very much informed by the findings of the Independent Infrastructure Commission Scotland. And I think one of the points I would put across about the development of the IIP is that we tend to take quite a consultative approach to that. So in the case of the current IIP, that was put out for consultation, and the final version of the IIP reflected some of the views that came back. So the IIB as a board has a role, but it's by no means the only place where input comes into the infrastructure plan. In relation to the development of the IIP, you'll understand that each IIP doesn't start with a blank sheet of paper. So given the nature of infrastructure investment, multi-year programmes and projects, and also the need to maintain the existing public sector asset base, each IIP is the kind of next step in the journey, if you like, rather than completely redrawing the infrastructure plans that were taken forward. So in relation to how the plan is developed, working with portfolios, we engage through my team in infrastructure division with the portfolios with the large infrastructure requirements, projects and programmes, look at their requirements, their forecasts, and also intersect between some of the vision and overarching objectives that we want to set for our overall plan with the plans that are developed in individual sectors. So, for example, in transport, things like the Strategic Transport Projects Review, long-term infrastructure plans within health, so that our overall infrastructure plan needs to take into account the plans that exist in these sectors. So there's a lot of engagement with portfolios in order to do that. I think the last initial point I would make is that you'll be aware that the current infrastructure plan was published at the same time as a capital spending review. So another key link there is between the budget and the funding available to us and the projects and programmes that we want to take forward. So in relation to the current plan, it was published not just to set out the policies and programmes that we want to prioritise, but also matched alongside the budget process as well. So there's a few observations, but I'm happy to say a bit more if that would be helpful.
Okay, thanks. Can you tell me more about how you monitor overall progress and what information is provided to you? So once you've given out the plans, what updates do you get?
So in many respects, similar updates to yourselves as a committee. So the convener mentioned at the outset that you've got, you know, 6 months of reporting around the pipeline of major projects. So we have, you know, we use that ourselves internally and then use it to show transparency around the delivery of the plan and indeed engage with groups such as this committee. So that enables us to track progress against the plan overall. The point I'd make is that in terms of the individual delivery of specific projects and programmes, there's distinct accountability for the delivery of those within the portfolios, within the procuring authorities that are responsible for those projects. So from the perspective of the Infrastructure Investment Board, our interest is in the overall delivery of the plan and the contribution it's making to some of the high-level outcomes the government has set around net zero, economic development and so on, and the delivery of the National Infrastructure Mission. So we take a kind of strategic view of that, but as you've seen yourselves from the information we produce, we do have that information at a project and programme level as well.
So what relationship do you have then once the project, I'll use the ferries for example, what communication do you have when projects start to go wrong?
So through the pipeline and project reporting, we are able to see where how projects are comparing to outline business case, how they're performing in relation to time and cost. So we have that information about any variance within the different projects compared to those original plans. So we have that as a basic level of information. The composition of the Infrastructure Investment Board is deliberately set so that the members of the board represent the key areas of infrastructure development in Scottish Government, so transport, health, and so on. So we have that interaction at the high level with senior officials from the main areas that are looking after infrastructure.
And at what point do flags get raised with overspend or overruns of projects? So, and what is deemed as acceptable? So, and when would this be reported to Parliament?
So, I guess the starting point for that would be, in many respects, movements in budget on capital projects are similar to the rest of our budget approach. So, there's, you know, monthly monitoring of outturn against budgets. And that would include on capital budgets. And then if there are material changes that need to be made at the level of portfolio budgets, then that's something we'd bring forward to Parliament through autumn and spring budget revisions in terms of in-year movement. In relation to multi-year investment plans, then we have the opportunity to adjust that at annual budget and also in terms of periodic capital spending reviews and so on. So at the macro level, that would feed through our overall budget processes. I think in terms of specific projects, circumstances vary a little bit depending on the portfolio responsible and the procuring authority. In the larger areas where portfolios are managing a suite of projects and programmes, it's their responsibility to ensure that those are brought in within the budget available to them. But managing across a number of different projects, as a portfolio, you may have some scope to reflect an overspend in one with an unspend in another and manage that as a portfolio of projects. So there's a distinction between the kind of central budget processes and the delegated responsibilities around individual portfolios and procuring authorities.
So it's an annual update in the annual budget?
So there's a number of opportunities over the financial year. So at the kind of highest level in terms of our budget process, we tend to have two moments per year where in-year adjustments can be made, and as you know, there's the annual budget process as well. But that's very much at the macro level. In terms of the management of individual projects and programmes within that, then we would expect portfolios to manage those and movements in all sorts of spending programmes within the accountability that's been set for them. So they would be able to make changes during the year in terms of their management of individual projects and budgets.
Right, and again, I'm going to paragraph 19 that I've got. All accountable officers, whether director generals or chief executives of executive agencies or NDPBs, are personally answerable to the Parliament for the exercise of their functions of a duty to ensure propriety and regularity of public finances, ensure value for money of all related resources judged for the public sector as a whole, have clear lines of delegation and accountability and support for undertaking these functions, ensure risks are managed effectively, make sure procurement guidelines are met, secure best value, and seek written authority from ministers if any action is inconsistent with proper performance of the accountable officer's functions. So why would that go so badly wrong? I'm just looking specifically at the various stuff. Why would that go so badly wrong? Because every single one of those kind of guidelines seems to have failed, by the way.
So you appreciate I'm not personally involved in the Ferries project. So
for any other kind of procurement thing that we've got, because that started off with the procurement. So there's loads of issues that have been raised with procurement. So I'm just trying to see what it is that we'd be put in place to make sure that we don't have any of these things ongoing, because that's quite disastrous, really, what happened with the Ferries. So why did that happen in the first place when we've got these rules in place?
Okay, so I might ask Nick Ford to say a little bit more about some of the procurement rules that we follow and the guidance and support we offer to portfolios in respect of that. I'm not in a position to comment in detail on the specific example of the Ferries case. I know you'll appreciate that. I think what I would say is that from a central infrastructure perspective, one of our key interests is in learning lessons from experience across the infrastructure portfolio. We are extremely interested in terms of the overall support that can be provided to those managing significant contracts, and also in the guidance that we offer to accountable officers and senior responsible owners for projects and programmes. So there's a lot of advice and guidance set out in documents such as the Scottish Public Finance Manual, and there's a range of support for those that are leading major projects and programmes. So if there are lessons to be learned from particular experiences, we would want to obviously feed that back through into the processes that we have. But I might ask Nick to say just a little bit more about the support we can offer.
Yeah, thanks, Andrew. And obviously I wasn't directly involved in the Ferries either, but I can talk about it from a general perspective of how we manage procurement. And so the assurance process is very similar. It's empowered accountability. So every public body what's part of SPA, Scottish Public Finance Manual, needs to follow the procurement processes that are laid out, and will have their own sort of procurement governance procedures in place. So the SRO and the contracting authority is ultimately accountable for the procurement and ensuring the procurement process is followed. I think so in good governance, which is what we operate under in the PPM design principles, so you kind of around a first line, second line, third line of defence reporting. So the first line is fundamentally the project team delivering, in this case, delivering the ferries. And my directorate within Scottish Government is really in that second line. So we provide the policy, the guidance. If they come under SPFM, then obviously we provide the legislation, since procurement is a devolved matter, which they must follow. We provide the tool set, we provide capability building, and we can provide assurance and support to the teams. But accountability very much rests with the SRO, because fundamentally the SRO and the accounting officer is best placed to understand the context, the risks, how to mitigate and follow through on that. So that's kind of how it works. But obviously, the procurement part is, and I think procurement part is quite often used in a kind of broad liberal sense, because obviously there's different stages, whether it's the design part, the actual specific procurement process itself, or then more in the contract management phase. And I think within probably the ferries, it's probably more in that contract management phase where the issues were actually occurred, rather than actually in the procurement aspects of it. But and then another probably key part just to pick up is the lesson learning, which feeds back from obviously part of my directorate's role is to really spread that sort of good practice, case studies, back out and capability building within procurement teams, what may sit within a directorate or a public body.
Right, okay. just one of the points I think you just said there, if there are lessons to be learned, one of the things as well, it does say finally that IIB has a role to ensure that there is a reflection and learning taken from new complex or innovative investments and that these are effectively shared across portfolios. So again, what are the issues that have been raised through, and again, it's the Fairies that I'm specifically referring to, there's lots of lessons that have to be learned. So what have you taken from that so far and implemented and shared amongst all the other portfolios so that it doesn't happen again? With the likes of, you know, recording meetings and making sure paperwork doesn't go missing. And so what actions have you taken based on what you've already heard from the issues in the Fairies contract?
Let me start to answer that and then ask Helen Carter to say a little bit about some of our improvement programme that's underway. So I think, I mean, in relation to issues like recording meetings, I guess that is, in some respects, a wider issue around the operation of government and not specifically a point about infrastructure. However, you know, we would always expect good practice to be shown in relation to the audit trail and documentation around large infrastructure projects and the way in which contracts are managed. So I think there probably is quite a good set of guidance already around what good practice looks like in relation to the management of contracts. What the Infrastructure Investment Board tends to do is look for strategic kind of trends across the management of projects. So, for example, recent issues that we've been looking at include the impact of COVID and things like supply chain risks and inflation on the delivery of the infrastructure programme. So those are the types of issues that we tend to look at in this particular forum that we're describing to you today. We do have an existing programme of improvement across the infrastructure investment landscape. Again, in the first instance, informed by the recommendations of the Independent Commission on Infrastructure, but we also clearly look at Audit Scotland reports and other reports and findings into the delivery of projects. So I would say that there's a natural home there to learn, to apply lessons learned from other experiences. So if it's helpful, I might just ask Helen to say a little bit about our existing improvement programme.
Thank you. As Andrew said, the Infrastructure Commission for Scotland set out a number of recommendations, some of which were taken forward in the current infrastructure investment plan that we published in February 2021. But it also suggested some improvements that could be made over the course of the current infrastructure investment plan in time for the next publication in 2025 or 26. There are three components that we're working on for improvement, including a long-term needs assessment to inform what is actually required for Scotland to meet future infrastructure needs. The Infrastructure Commission looked at a 30-year horizon, so the current IIP only spans 5 years. So, you know, what's the next step in that to be taken forward, planning for the future? To also look at the appraisal and prioritisation frameworks that are in place to, in order to assess where the capital investment is best utilised, and also looking at public engagement and having an enhanced role for public engagement in future plans.
Okay, thanks. Can I ask about the IIB's role in developing the overall strategic direction for infrastructure investment and in balancing competing priorities both between and within different portfolios and programmes?
Yeah, again, I'll maybe kick off on that and might draw on a couple of colleagues. So I suppose some of the points I made earlier are relevant to that question in relation to how the IIP has developed, drawing in perspectives from across Scottish Government portfolios in relation to the key sectoral plans, such as health, transport and so on. In relation to the current IIP, it was very much informed by the findings of the Infrastructure Commission, and it's based around priorities such as net zero and the need to develop a strong resourceful economy. I think your point about competing priorities is a really challenging one, I think, for anybody involved in infrastructure at the level of government. I think the IIP tries to strike a good balance between achieving different objectives across what's a very wide-ranging programme. In relation to the current IIP, one of the things we very consciously did was to try to shift spending towards the achievement of our climate change targets. So you would find within the IIP the announcement of the Low Carbon Fund. In developing the IIP, we used that as a particular driver for how do we prioritise across so many different portfolios and sectors in a way that achieves a cumulative impact on net zero. So that was a device that we employed in this IIP that we hadn't done previously, and I think it's borne out in terms of the shifts we're seeing towards net zero expenditure. I think another way of approaching the question is to look at some principles for investment. So one of the themes for the current IIP was around the benefit of maintaining existing assets and prioritising that. It doesn't mean we don't invest in new projects as well, but there was a finding from the Commission that really prioritising maintenance was important for a number of reasons. So if you can find some overarching principles that are kind of neutral in terms of individual portfolios or policies or sectors, that enables you to arrive at some conclusions about how to prioritise across what's a very diverse set of options. So those are two themes I would point out from the current IIP in relation to our approach to that.
Okay. Anyone else wanting to?
Can I give a perspective from health? So yeah. Our governance in some ways kind of reflects or is similar to the way that Andrew described the infrastructure board. The NHS has their own infrastructure board. The co-chair of that is a member of the Scottish Government's Infrastructure Board. So he kind of provides both feedback on the issues that are important to health, and equally he will reflect the priorities of the Scottish Government's Infrastructure Board and make sure that that's reflected in our infrastructure plan. So that when we, for example, kind of Andrew kind of mentioned that the importance of maintaining our existing estate, and so over the 5-year period in the infrastructure plan, we're committed to doubling our maintenance over that kind of 5-year period. Another example would be in terms of net zero requirements that we now have we've basically said to NHS boards that if you're going to develop an infrastructure project, it needs to be net zero. And so that in itself is quite challenging, and we've put, if you like, the challenge to boards to kind of come up with these innovative designs and ways of designing new healthcare facilities that reflect that government priority. So I think that's a kind of very clear example of where we link in with the Scottish Government infrastructure's priorities, at the same time as we get the opportunity to put forward our case for investment in health and social care.
Could I just add, from a transport point of view, we've recently published earlier this year the Strategic Transport Projects Review, which looked at all transport infrastructure across Scotland and looked at what the gaps and shortfalls in the networks were, whether they were ferries, which you mentioned earlier, the rail network or the road network. But that was on the back of a national transport strategy refresh, which was published a couple of years ago, which is really aiming towards sustainable modes now. So in terms of competing priorities, sustainable modes are much more favoured over roads, for example, although roads are still able to go forward if they've got environmental or safety benefits, for example, and also people mentioned about maintaining existing assets and making sure that they were safe. So there's quite a scale of different priorities. So the emphasis is changing away perhaps from a lot of road building, unless it's targeted improvements, for more infrastructure around cycling, walking and public transport related infrastructure.
Okay, thank you. I'll just put a wee shout out for the A77 if you're ever any spare cash. That's me. Thank you, convener.
Right, thank you very much. And just for the avoidance of doubt, this is not an unscheduled proxy session on the delivery of vessels 801 and 802. Let me return to governance and accountability. And Andrew Watson, you mentioned that you had given us a written submission in advance, which I think is very useful to us. One thing that struck me about it, I have to say, and I think in one part of the paper, you say infrastructure strategy is developed through a range of mechanisms. And I have to say, when I read through the paper and I see that there's a Scottish Futures Trust, that there is an Infrastructure Investment Board, that there's an Infrastructure Commission for Scotland, there's an Infrastructure Advisory Group, and Alan Morrison's just told us about a Departmental Infrastructure Board. How do these all fit together? What are the respective roles? Is the duplication, is it over-bureaucratic, or do you view it as working perfectly well?
So I think it is working well. We should always challenge ourselves to avoid duplication, and I think the way of mitigating against that is to be really clear about the different roles and responsibilities of different parts of our structure. And I think we have that in place. Some of the examples you mentioned there are not permanent. So the Infrastructure Commission for Scotland was established for a particular purpose and has reported. And I think what the structure and the mechanisms reflect is the complexity in the landscape here. So as we've discussed already, it's a diverse brief in terms of our infrastructure investment programme, multi-billion programme per year, and at the level at which you need the expertise, the oversight and the accountability for individual projects, that does require the infrastructure to be put in place around that to ensure effective delivery, governance and so on. So we have, I think rightly, got this system of delegated responsibility within portfolios and public bodies for the delivery of individual projects and programmes. And you then need a governance structure on top of that that reflects that system. So I think in relation to points in the governance, such as the Infrastructure Investment Board, as we said in the paper, that is primarily a strategy setting board. And the raison d'etre behind having that is to say, actually, we need somewhere where across government we can bring in those different perspectives to chart a vision and a clear direction at the highest level across infrastructure. If you look at bodies such as Scottish Futures Trust, again, their remit is different. So they've been established to do a number of things. In the early years of the Futures Trust, you'll know it was particularly engaged in the revenue financed programme for infrastructure, but it also provides a range of expert services and advice across government and indeed beyond government into other public bodies where they've got professional view and skills to offer. So I would say that each part of the landscape does something a bit different and distinct. It's quite complex, but I think it hangs together reasonably well.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned Scottish Futures Trust, and they're listed in your paper as being a key advisor to the IIB, but the IIB has also got an infrastructure advisory group. I mean, who's on the SFT and who's on the advisory group, and why are their roles different? And what advice do they give you which is different, or is it not just duplication?
So I don't think it is duplication. I think the Infrastructure Advisory Group is primarily a place where those developing policy in different parts within Scottish Government can come together to ensure that there's a consistency and a join-up, that things are moving in a reasonably coherent direction to deliver things like the Infrastructure Investment Plan and some of the overarching outcomes that actually span more than one part of government. So that supports the IIB in many respects. The Scottish Futures Trust is a public body in its own right with a whole range of different functions. It does have a different set of skills within that, and doesn't only provide an input to the IIB, but it also works in partnership with directly with delivery bodies delivering projects on the ground. It also brings in some of the skills that we see between the public and the private sector in a way that within government can be more difficult. So it has a range of functions, not just to provide an input to the IIB, but actually to work across the public body landscape in Scotland.
Okay, my final question for the moment is, so Helen, Nick and Andrew, you're on the IIB. Yeah. So who's on the infrastructure advisory group?
Yeah, so we can provide membership of that for the committee if you would like. It's a slight generalisation, but I would say that the IIB brings together the kind of senior leaders across the main functions in government that have a stake or a role to play in the delivery of infrastructure. So next year's an example in terms of procurement as a cross-cutting function that provides a professional support across government. And we also bring in senior officials from Health, Transport Scotland and so on. The Infrastructure Advisory Group tends to be at director and deputy director level, bringing together policymakers from across the main parts of government. So there's a bit of a distinction in the seniority of the membership of the different groups, and that then has a bearing on the agendas and the topics of discussion for the different bodies, if that makes sense.
Okay, and the minutes are available publicly.
So we provide the IIB minutes to Audit Scotland.
Okay, but are they published on the Scottish Government website?
I don't know if that's there.
Not at present.
I mean, you can get back to us with more detail on that if that would be useful to you. I'm now going to turn to Craig Hoy, who's got some questions to put. Craig.
Thank you, Richard. Good morning, Mr. Watson. Just like to turn and perhaps take a little bit deeper into the governance assurance and oversight at both the portfolio and the project level, and to see if there's any tension, overlap or gaps that exist within that. So firstly, I suppose, if your colleague would like to just explain more about the role of the portfolio investment boards in authorising projects and whether those arrangements differ across different portfolio areas, for example, with Mr. Morrison in Health or Mr. Shackman in Transport.
Alan and Lawrence to give you some examples from their two areas. My only comment would be, as I think you've said yourself, there's a bit of diversity across the portfolios given their size and their scale and their functions. So there's some discretion for local arrangements to reflect that. But I think colleagues might say a bit more.
So in health, the risk of throwing another group into the mix, but there's an NHS Capital Investment Group which specifically reviews business cases submitted to the Scottish Government for capital projects. It basically covers all projects that are above a board's delegated level. And in general terms, for the bigger boards, like Greater Glasgow and Clyde and Lothian, anything over £10 million needs to come to government. The smaller boards, roughly about £5 million, anything in excess of that needs to come to us. We have our own bespoke kind of guidance, the Scottish Capital Investment Manual that we provide, that sits underneath the Scottish Public Finance Manual, that basically has a step-by-step process for boards as to what they need to do in order to develop a business case that will be supported. It's three stages. There's an initial agreement, there's an outline business case, and then there's a full business case. So it takes a long time. It's something that we're kind of conscious of whether we can speed that up and make that kind of quicker. But effectively, the Capital Investment Group includes basically representatives from across Scottish Government Health and Social Care Directorates. It also has Scottish Futures Trust, who provide invaluable challenge and thought on a board's kind of proposals, and also Health Facilities Scotland, NHS Assure, who sit on that group. They will then make a consideration as to whether the business case is supported or not. If we do recommend it for approval, it then goes to the Director General, and it's her that makes the ultimate decision. If we don't accept it, which is not particularly unusual, we'll go back and we'll say your business case fell short in these various areas, and then you need to go back, and almost always they go reconsider it, resubmit it, and then we go through the process again.
Transport.
Yeah, so in Transport Scotland, the Chief Executive is the accountable officer, and he has a system in place, investment decision makers process, which uses the other directors in Transport Scotland to advise him on whether projects should proceed through the various key gateway stages, strategic business case, outline business case and final business case in particular. And he'll also be guided by outputs from gateway reviews which are undertaken at key stages of projects. And we would feed our projects into IIB. I think typically over £20 million projects will be registered with IIB, and they're updated on the 6-monthly basis, as previously mentioned. We also have another fairly independent body, ARC, which is the risk body within Transport Scotland, which has a challenge function, accountability and risk committee, which has a challenge function to the various projects to make sure that they are going through due process properly, that they've got the adequate funding in place, that they've looked at the risk profiles, and that's fed back into the projects themselves, which are governed obviously at a project level in the particular directorate within Transport Scotland, whether it's roads, ferries, rail, etc. So there's a higher degree of assurance of projects going through that investment decision makers process and onwards to IIB for reporting purposes.
And typically how long would that process take to complete to your satisfaction?
Well, for a particular project it could take years. Generally road projects, for example, take several years to come to realisation. I'll pick on the Queensferry Crossing. That took 10 years from start to finish, from implementation to completion, and that will have gone through several gateway reviews. It will have been subject to Audit Scotland reviews. It will have gone through investment decision making processes at a much more pointed level, if you like, because the chief executive actually sat on a project board, a bespoke project board, which met typically every 6 weeks. So there was a high degree of control on the project and oversight to make sure that things ran smoothly, and that if there were any problems, they were picked up and obviously acted on timeously.
There is obviously a natural tension between the need to do things properly and to get the infrastructure projects in place quickly, because they do tend to follow demand. Take, for example, Sheriffall Roundabout, for example, being one. Is there anything in the process that could be done to make sure that you could keep all the checks and balances in place but accelerate those projects where there is a need to get them done with some urgency?
There is. I mean, the issue really is that there's a statutory process that we have to go through. People have to have their say on a project. It has to be open and transparent, and we use our website to a very large degree to make sure that the public are informed about our projects and that they have a chance to give their views. And in the case of Sheriffall Roundabout, I know there was a huge number of letters of objections raised, and it's likely to go to a public local inquiry, so people can have their views heard, and a report, independent reporter will report on that. So it's not always easy to actually accelerate projects. Sometimes it's because of where they are, they impact on a lot of people. Some other projects they have minimal impact, if I can put it like that, or they may have different kinds of issues. They might be environmental issues, or they may be people-driven issues. So wherever possible, we'll try and speed processes up. Sorry to go back to the Queensferry Crossing, but on that particular project, we ran a parallel bill process to get the authorisation for the project alongside the procurement process, which saved at least a year on the project programme. So it is possible to do those sorts of things.
In parallel.
Yeah.
Obviously, post-approval, Mr. Watson, what is the role of the individual portfolio investment boards in overseeing the programmes and the projects as they develop, and what nature is the engagement that they have and their interaction with the other bodies delivering the projects and the individual project managers, and how does that all then relate into the Infrastructure Investment Board as a project develops?
Okay, so I might ask Alan and Lawrence to say a bit more about that, and then we'll come back with the IIB link at the end. Okay.
So again, through the Capital Investment Group, we review post-project evaluations. It's a mandatory part of the guidance that we issue. And then what we do is we have a network that we arrange with dominantly NHS staff, where we update them on a range of issues. And if we thought there was anything particularly kind of coming out of any post-project evaluation, we would share that with the people who are similarly kind of
developing projects. It's probably something that we could do better. It's quite difficult finding the balance between somebody writing an honest appraisal of where things could get right, and I think there's sometimes a natural inclination to be, you know, not necessarily be that open about where things could go on. So we try and put it in a way that it's kind of supportive. It's to help the people that are coming behind them.
But if you could do it better, why aren't you doing it better?
I think it's one of the challenges is the range of time it takes to kind of cover a big project. And so the people that started out with the idea to develop a piece of health infrastructure are often not there at the end, and having that kind of continuity can sometimes make it difficult to kind of go back and sense what did they do, and quite often that the a key thing is your benefits realization that you're going to do right at the start of the project. If you find out that is not been as good as it should have been, it makes it difficult to make that assessment. So that's one of the things that you asked about. It's a kind of a really important question about can we do things quicker. But we will get business cases, we will look at the benefits realisation, we think that's not good enough, we need you to kind of go back and develop it better. So that's where there's a tension between, you know, we realise that will lengthen the project and it will make it take longer, but we try and make an assessment as to, whether a project starts 6 months later or not, that we try and look at the whole kind of life cycle of the whole project that will be, in use for 50, 60, 70 years and try and kind of look at it that way. But it's difficult finding that right balance.
Would that be, for example, would the Sick Kids be an example of that, for example?
So there's obviously kind of a lot of kind of reviews kind of going on about the Sick Kids, and the public inquiry will there'll be lessons coming out from that. Because boards have been focused on managing the pandemic, we've not been as demanding of post-project evaluations kind of coming in. But that's certainly something that that we will kind of look at and share in terms of what we need to learn from that.
Mr. Chapman, Mr. Transport.
Yeah, we have processes in place to make sure that we undertake robust post-project evaluation, and those, as Alan was saying, are keyed to the objectives which are set out right at the beginning of the project, because otherwise why would you have the objectives if you haven't actually realised the benefits from them? There are various other things to consider as well about interaction with the public and lots of different evaluation points, not just the functionality of the infrastructure that's been built. But I suppose a good example of a post-project evaluation process is the Borders Railway, which was built a good few years ago now, 5-6 years ago. So that had a benefits realisation process applied to it, which looked at how the railway had impacted on the area, how it was built, the impacts during construction, how they were managed. And there's several other examples of projects. I could go on about Queensferry Crossing again, but so the project, the benefits realisation is really keyed into what were your original objectives. And have you achieved those? Have you exceeded those objectives? Have you met them? And that's also tied into the lessons learnt, which we mentioned earlier, and how we can actually improve processes. And sometimes we've seen that as projects have developed over the years, and I mentioned that a lot of the transport infrastructure projects take several years to develop and deliver. We've seen that, like with modern technology, we can do better things with communicating with the public. We don't just have face-to-face meetings anymore because of what's happened with COVID to a large extent. We can have virtual exhibitions over your laptop. We can get people to participate in communication exercises and express their views via online surveys. So there's a lot of new methods, and that's where lessons learnt really comes to help us a lot.
In relation to IAB, so what we would do is kind of take the overall learning from the different portfolios and consider whether there are particular things that need to be emphasised in the way in which the organisation is working more generally, Some of those could be in the procurement space, they could be in the project management space, learning and development for staff. There could be issues around capacity, and the IIB might legitimately take a view on capacity within government and public bodies. Alan mentioned the issues around legislation and statutory requirements. So there'd be a range of what I describe more as the kind of cross-cutting lessons learned from across a number of different experiences that the IIB might then want to take a view on and influence the overall direction of the way in which Scottish Government approaches these things.
Finally, just one very brief question, I'm aware we are short on time, Convener. Obviously, the two big risks are cost savings and overruns, and also when projects don't run to schedule. Are these being effectively managed across portfolios? And do you understand that, are the lines of communication between the various authorities, are they effective to make sure that we really get on top of those cost savings or project overruns?
So I think I would say that they are effective, but we are always open-minded about areas for possible improvement. I think you'll have seen yourself from our reporting that we have a good awareness, good grasp of the position on the major projects in terms of how they're performing against time and budget. I mentioned earlier that we've had a particular interest in recent years, as you'd expect, on the really severe impact of COVID on project delivery. So it's an obvious statement, isn't it? But it has just been the key factor, and that's been borne out in some of the reports that we've provided. So to come out of that phase of activity, but then are very much looking at issues around the impact of inflation on costs. We need to make sure that we understand those impacts and are able to understand the cumulative effect across the government's overall programme. It doesn't remove the need for individual budget holders, portfolios, delivery authorities to manage those risks and build them into contracts and procurement and so on. So one of our roles, I think, is to continue to ensure that people have the right guidance and skills around that, and we've got a range of action in hand to ensure that's the case.
Thanks.
I'm now going to bring Willie Coffey in, who I think has got some related questions to this area. Willie.
Convener, thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to everybody. Could I maybe take you back to the beginning of all processes for all projects, Andrew? This committee has been focused over many years about quality standards and the application of standards in the design specification part of any project. And we're believers that if you get it right at the outset, you're likely to get it right at the end. And the opposite is true. If you don't get it right at the beginning, you're unlikely to deliver anything on time and budget. And we've mentioned a couple of examples today. Lawrence mentioned the Queen's Ferry Crossing. So at both ends of the scale, we can see the successes in the Queen's Ferry Crossing, Borders Railway, and even the A77 Maybole Bypass. But at the other end of the scale, we're seeing the ferries issue. Do you, as a team, insist that quality standards are in place for all projects, no matter what we're building? It could be a bridge, a road, a school, even a piece of software or a ferry. Do we look at the whole range of projects that are on the books and look specifically for that, the presence of that, and do we require it of all these projects? Because it seems to me that if you don't, you're at great risk of projects just running out of kilter and over cost. So do we require that at the outset?
Yeah, so I think I mentioned at the outset some of the responsibilities for accountable officers and budget holders around value for money and regularity of expenditure and so on. So there's a whole set of requirements around the management of public money, including in relation to infrastructure projects. I might ask Nick to say just a little bit more about some of the standards we set around procurement and contract management and so on, because you're right, there are some guidelines around this, good practice, and the importance of applying good PPM principles to these projects. But Nick, can maybe say just a little bit.
Yeah, happy to. Whether it's, I think, procurement or programme management, it's a bit of a similar example, I think. And if you take the sort of the first line, second line, third line I described earlier, the procurement, if I use procurement professionals, because obviously that's more to my home, it's a very broad church. When we look at the people undertaking public procurement across Scotland, scattered, length and breadth of Scotland, whether that's in a local authority, a health trust, or in central government. And how do we drive up the capability of those individuals so you've got that consistent application of good practice and good standards across all procurements that are undertaken? So from the centre, we provide, as mentioned before, the legislation, the policies, the guidance. We've actually got an industry lead in procurement journey, which is an online platform that is available free of charge. So Scottish Government provides to all public procurement professionals, where we put the guidance, the tool sets, the standards, what we expect, tools that can help measure their capability against. And obviously we can update that really quickly when we bring in new lessons learned. The challenge, though, is obviously because it's a board church and our remit is more in that second line, is how do we kind of get that level of insurance that really drives up? And bearing in mind, you know, we've changes in staff and personnel where they'll say it's a difficult and challenging job, I think, to keep raising the bar on the standards, but that's absolutely what we need to try and drive. And I think leadership and capability is probably one of the key areas we'd focus on. Good PPM, when you talk about lessons learned, we've mentioned that a lot, you know, whether that's at the project level, whether it's at the functional level, or whether it's third line in Audit Scotland reports. Plenty of lesson learning, but how are we really building that learning culture in teams so they're absorbing it, they're embracing it, they're taking on, they're seeking out best practice, and then they're applying it. And that's, I think, probably that next step, what we need to continue to work on.
But at the outset, though, do you think, you know, do we invest enough time and effort at the beginning of any of these processes for the work going on in the capital programme to make sure that specification and design and cost estimates are thorough, good, reliable, deliverable, all of that? Because there are great examples of great delivery, but there are spectacularly bad ones. What I'm interested in is why can't we spot it early enough to stop it becoming a bad one? What, there must be key ingredients that are going wrong in a specific project that we must surely be familiar now with all the tools at our disposal. What are the secrets to finding out as early as we can that something's potentially going to go wrong? Alan?
Yeah. Again, from a health perspective, so we obviously we had a couple of major kind of problems with the Edinburgh Children's Hospital and the Queen Elizabeth. It resulted in the public inquiry being set up, but pretty much immediately after the ventilation problems were identified in the Edinburgh Children's Hospital, we accepted that this was not, we needed to do something different. So we established NHS Assure, which is basically an assurance role that is run through NSS and National Services Scotland, who outline and full business case go through a key stage assurance review with the board, and they go through effectively they look at the six key critical systems that from water, ventilation, electrics, fire safety. And they will challenge the board, and they'll kind of say, well, you know, does it comply with all NHS standards? Do they have the strategies in place to ensure that they'll deliver it? And again, where we find it's that challenge, because sometimes the board need to go back and either do things differently. And that kind of push out the timeline for when the project starts, the construction phase. But we think that the potential time saved by identifying a problem is worth that investment, because it's a relatively new body. So most of their work has been focused at the business case development. It's a key part of our. We will not approve a business case unless NHS Assure have said they're supportive of it going forward. And then as we have more projects going into the construction phase, we expect on-site visits and reviews of this construction taking place. So that's what we've put in place to address the problems that we clearly had in our programme.
But I say to you, Alan, does it not tend to happen after the event, though? Like that example there, the thing was built and installed and it was done. Why can't we spot that there's an issue before it's done?
So this is what we're we kind of recognise that was the problem, and quality has been an issue. So we are we're going back to in the design phase. So basically, all the design drawings will be submitted to NHS Assure, and they will go through it and undertake a technical review of it, and they will kind of challenge the anything that they see, and I'm not technical, so I can't really kind of give details as to what the kind of things that they're looking for, but clearly that the compliance with the technical guidance that is produced by the NHS is a key part of that review. And what we are expecting is that will lead to better quality and also lead to identifying problems in advance, and so you fix them then rather than halfway through the build you kind of go, this doesn't fit into that hole.
I do understand what you're saying, and I'm familiar with that, but these issues keep coming in front of us and the Auditor General discovers them and this committee gets oversight of it, and committee members always live wondering, why couldn't we spot these things earlier? Is there a lack of rigour perhaps in the design phase? I mean, we heard the example with the ferries, that the cables weren't even long enough in the boat to reach where they should have reached. I mean, why can't we see that earlier, even in a design document, to avoid doing it? But it tends to happen, then we try and correct it and learn the lessons at the end and feed it back into the next process, which is great and it's the right thing to do. But I'm really curious about why we can't see it at an early enough stage to prevent the errors initially. Lawrence?
I can't comment on the ferries issue that you just mentioned, but certainly in terms of road projects, things have moved on in leaps and bounds over the last 20 years, I would say 25 years, in terms of how we monitor the projects through right from the initial phases of development, and also spending money at an early stage on things like ground investigation, because most of the problems on civil engineering projects are actually emanate from what's in the ground or what's not in the ground sometimes. So doing our homework at an early stage and getting the right team in place, so you've got a good professional team, which is often a blend of civil servants and consultants who are professionally qualified to develop designs and implement them through the procurement processes, which Nick alluded to just now. Quite often the devil is in the detail, so you need to have people looking at the documents and making sure that your contract documents are written correctly and that they're checked and double-checked. And also when you get out on site that you've got the right monitoring team there so that you don't miss things out and you do enough competence checking, if you like. A lot of the civil engineering projects we have in Transport Scotland are self-certified in that the contractor has to sign up to all the drawings that he does, that the actual works that are undertaken are designed and checked by not only the contractor but also the contractor's designer. So there is a high degree of confidence that what actually you see built out on the park or wherever it is actually competent and complies with all the relevant standards. So there's a lot of things go into making sure that a project does stand up to the rigours that it should be judged on. And I think a lot of the time now in the last 20 years we've moved much more towards collaborative contracts. So Transport Scotland as client has really tried to collaborate with industry, so the contractors and the designers that are actually helping us to deliver these projects. So, and sorry to go back to Queensferry Crossing, but that's an example of where all the people involved in the project were all co-located on the site to try and make sure that as issues arose, and every project has issues, that they were addressed as quickly as they could be. And that everyone could see everyone else's angle. So, you know, if Transport Scotland are working on a briefing for a committee such as this, we used to go to committees regularly throughout the whole of that programme to report on progress, that everyone understood their role and that we could work together as a team as much as the contract allows, of course. And contracts are moving on all the time to be more collaborative and make sure that these issues are foreseen and solved as soon as possible.
My last query, convener, that, I mean, those principles, Lawrence, that you described there, I think are applicable no matter what you're building. And so the question for us is, are they being applied across the board to other sectors? And I mentioned a whole range of things that we might build in this capital programme. It's that level of depth and rigour and investment and time and effort in design and specification and so on. If that's replicated across the board, we stand a good chance of delivering all of this stuff in the programme on time and budget. Can you, Andrew, give the committee an assurance that that's your understanding of the whole range of what's in front of us, what's in the programme right now, has that depth, that rigour across the board that Lawrence described in his sector, that can be applied to all of the capital programme and we can look forward to them all being delivered on time and budget?
So I can't personally guarantee that every single project in our wide programme will be delivered on time and budget. Nobody could do that. But I think, we spoke earlier about the relative complexity of our structures, but they are, I think, designed to help ensure that some of the learning across these quite different portfolios is applied more generally. So there is a space to consider that and feed those standards, those experiences into the guidance that we offer across government, through our procurement practices, through our the kind of recruitment approach in terms of people coming into governments and delivery authorities, the construction of teams and so on. I think there are a number of parts of the public sector that have long experience in delivering major projects, and you've heard about two just now. I think one issue that we are thoughtful about is, you know, areas where there's a lack of experience in delivering a project in a portfolio, or a lack of scale, and that's where we bring in some of the support we can offer from the procurement perspective, sometimes bodies such as Scottish Futures Trust and so on. So there's something around creating that supportive culture to ensure that the very best standards you've heard about, I think, from colleagues in health and transport are spread across the piece.
Very helpful answers. Thank you very much. Thanks, Commissioner.
Thanks, Willie. Conscious of time, but Colin Beattie is next, so Colin, over to you.
Thank you, Commissioner. I'm looking at prioritisation and funding of the major capital project, and a slightly lumpy question for you to answer. How do you determine the overall budget and type of funding for different programmes and projects, and how do you prioritise between portfolios, including what the roles are for ministers and for officials? I don't know if that's something you would answer, Andrew.
Okay, I'll start at that one. So, talked a bit about in this session around the development of the IEP and what goes into that. So one of the purposes of the Infrastructure Investment Plan is to set that overall strategy for the projects and programmes we want to take forward. And that can give us the ability to shift priorities if we want to, or reach difficult decisions about competing priorities. And I've talked a little bit about the focus on net zero and maintenance as two examples of that. So that overall strategy helps with the prioritisation approach. I mentioned that each IIP doesn't start from a blank sheet of paper, so one of the key factors in our budget setting is existing projects, programmes and the maintenance of our existing assets. So in setting annual budgets or through a spending review, a multi-year financial plan, clearly we look at existing legal and contractual commitments and we need to factor that into our budget setting. In relation to the current IIP, as I mentioned earlier, we worked in parallel on the capital spending review to ensure that we had a multi-year budget plan that stacked up against the policies and programmes in the IIP. In terms of the annual budget process, you'll be familiar with the fact that we obviously set out updated annual capital spending plans in each successive budget, and that's part of our routine budget processes, engaging with portfolios about their spending projections and priorities for the year ahead. We look at the mix of funding sources, so you'll be aware that we have a strategy for capital borrowing, as an example, which we set out in our medium-term financial strategy. So we have a medium-term plan on capital borrowing and how that supports our programme. But then we also take annual decisions about actual borrowing in any given year, depending on spend against budget and trends in that sense. So there's a whole range of processes around the budget which are relevant. There's the role of the IIP is setting the overall strategy. There's engagement with portfolios on the state on the ground in terms of existing projects and their strategies for going forward. And then ultimately, we have the task of supporting ministers in reaching an overall view about how to prioritise and allocate budgets between all these different things. And then, as you know, we've also made significant efforts to ensure that's a kind of public process. So clearly, the Parliament has to approve the annual budget, but we've also been consulting widely on our infrastructure plans as well and feeding that into our process.
You mentioned about informing, you know, giving ministers advice in terms of the value, presumably, and prioritisation on projects and so forth. Is that a lengthy process? Is it a complex process?
So I'd say it's kind of a continuous process in many respects, because you've got the need to set a medium-term perspective on financial planning and projects. You've got the annual budget process, and you've got the management of spend in year as well. So there's many layers to that. So it's a kind of continuous process, but we then also have other factors as well. So there could be movements in our overall funding position as a result of, for example, UK fiscal events, UK spending reviews, cost increases, and so on. So it is a complex set of issues that we need to manage. Some of that is managed within our overall budgeting processes, and some of it is specific to infrastructure. I would say I'd describe it as a kind of continuous process, probably the best way of putting it.
Just as a kind of an extension of that, to what extent is the affordability of planned infrastructure investment determined or dependent on external factors?
So there are a number of external factors with a bearing. So we've talked a little bit about issues around supply chain and inflation. So the cost profile of projects is subject to some fluctuation because of those sorts of external factors. We are, in terms of the overall composition of the Scottish budget, a lot of that is still determined by a block grant from the UK government, including on capital. So that can also have an impact on the overall funding envelope available to us for projects. We've discussed a bit this morning, you know, movements in the time and budget of individual projects. So we need to take that into account as well. Overall movements in the economy can have an impact as well. So yes, you're right, there are a wide number of factors that need to be taken into account. And I suppose that's one of the challenges in setting a strategy for infrastructure. So it's the right thing to do, in my opinion, to set that medium-term strategy. It gives you the capacity to plan, but you also need the ability to be flexible as you deliver each of these medium-term strategies along the way.
Just turning to a slightly different aspect again, NPD has been with us for quite some time now, and we've had discussions on this in this committee over a number of years. Could someone supply me, or the committee, with a copy of the formula for NPD as it is at the moment?
Okay, so I might ask Helen to comment, or indeed.
I'm not necessarily asking you to give us a dissertation on it now, but if you could supply.
So I'm very happy to do that. So there is a range of information about the underpinning of NPD on I think the Scottish Futures Trust website. We have provided a fair bit of information on that to Parliament over the years. As you say, it's been quite a long-standing programme. But rather than go into that just now, given your time, I'll take that away, but we can provide some further information.
Now, you're busy developing a new model, mutual investment model. How far along the road is that yet?
So I might ask Helen to comment briefly on that.
So as part of the National Infrastructure Mission, which government agreed to increase the level of infrastructure investment by 2025-26, Scottish Futures Trust were commissioned to prepare a paper on the use of the mutual investment model. It set out the sectors that it would be applicable to, and the government reviewed that. That paper went to IIB as well, and then ultimately ministers took the decision to agree that the mutual investment model could be considered as a future funding route for central government projects, where as opposed to local authority projects, because local authorities have got access to PWLB borrowing, whereas central borrowing is constrained. So the model, it was a variation on the Welsh model. There are a couple of projects underway using that in Wales. And consideration is being given to using it for projects within transport, but we've said in the capital spending review that it can be considered for the remaining elements of the U9, but there are, as yet, there are no active projects and no decision has been taken on the use of it going forward. But it's another tool in the toolbox, if you like, to maximise infrastructure investment within the National Infrastructure Mission, utilising all various funding sources that we have at our disposal.
Would it be possible, since it seems to have been fleshed out, would it be possible also to see the formula for that?
Yes.
So, very happy to take an action away to give you a paper on the fundamentals of the MPD and the MIM.
That would be excellent. Yeah. Thank you.
Yep, thank you very much, Nate. That would be very helpful. Well, let me deal with a contemporary issue, but which has got its roots in a bit of history, and that's these PFI contracts and PPP contracts, Alan Morrison. I mean, I'm reminded, I think the First Minister announced, I can't remember if it was in the programme for government, but fairly recently, that the 24-bed East Ayrshire Community Hospital was going to be taken out of PFI and brought back into the public sector. And it was almost an early glimpse of what was to come. And we know that these contracts are now coming up towards the end of their period of private operation. So, you know, we're just interested in understanding a bit more about how that's working, what the plans are to manage that transition, because 24-bed East Ayrshire Community Hospital is quite small, but there are some big projects with presumably quite significant revenue implications for the public sector, which are coming towards the end of their life in the private sector. So I guess, you know, are they all coming into the public sector? What does that look like? What plans has the government got to manage that transition and then to run these assets after they have transferred? I'll start with Andrew Watson.
Okay, so I'll offer a couple of comments and then maybe ask Alan to comment on the health position. So have produced guidance on these matters, I think, in 2020. So there is some guidance available through the Scottish Futures Trust for those that have these issues on their plate. So we are providing support in that sense to the range of authorities affected by the issues you've described. I think, Alan, maybe if I could ask you to comment just a little bit on how the NHS is approaching this
issue. So it's something we're very aware of, and we have a separate team that is looking at the PFI landscape. One of the things that is key is that the horizon scanning, it needs to be years in advance, because all the contracts are different. So some the asset will turn to the public sector, some it will be you need to buy it back, and some will be if you do nothing, it just gets effectively extended again as a PFI extension. And we need to make sure that the decision we're making is the best decision rather than the only decision we can make, because we don't have the time to do everything in advance. A key consideration is maintenance, is make sure that the contractor has been maintaining the asset in the way that the contract stipulates, so that if we take it over and think, well, we've got £15 million of backlog maintenance, that's no use. So we need to kind of get out ahead of that. The East Ayrshire Community Hospital, it was opportunistic. The PFI provider were open to a buyout. It was initially proposed by NHS Ayrshire and Arran, and that's not always the case. That it's not unusual for the PFI provider to think that they're very happy with the contract and they don't want to buy it out, and so. It's not something that we're anticipating happening very often in the near future. Most of our the first wave PFIs are still at least kind of 5 years away from kind of coming to the end of the primary period. So we have that time, but there's a lot of work that needs to be done just to make sure that we don't inherit something that we that isn't. You know, something we don't want that isn't at the standard that we expect it to be.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that from an operational point of view, and I know you can't speak on matters of policy, but isn't it a matter of government policy that they wish to see these contracts brought back into the public sector, or have I misunderstood that?
So I think, you know, we would look at the individual specifics. I mean, as Alan says, there's quite a variety in terms of the contracts. I guess looking back over the periods, what we've aimed to do with things like the MPD programme is to see where improvements can be made in relation to that approach to contracts. So you see some of that reflected in the more recent revenue-funded projects delivered through MPD and Hub. I think, as Alan's described, you know, it's difficult to generalise when you have such a variable picture in terms of the state of contracts and the position of those in possession of the contracts. What we would always do is seek to ensure, you know, best use of public money and you know, how that is used to ensure the outcomes that we want to deliver from particular projects and assets.
Okay, I think that's helpful. I mean, I think in addition to the information that you've agreed to supply to the committee following the questions that that Colin Beattie, for example, had asked, it would be useful if you could furnish us with a copy of your 2020 guidance. And, you know, if you're in a position as well to supply us with the current policy guidance that you receive as civil servants and the plans that you've got. I mean, I think we understand that there are a multitude of different contracts and different exit arrangements and so on, but to the extent to which you can furnish us with the information that allows us to get that overview of where things are, I think that would be really helpful. I'm really sorry that we have run out of time, and I appreciate the fact that you've given us an undertaking to provide some of the evidence we were looking for in writing. That's very, very helpful indeed. So I want to thank you again for coming in this morning to give us the benefit of your insight into how the governance arrangements are working on these major capital projects, and thank you. And I'll draw this public part of the committee's session today to an end. Thank you very much. Thank you.